we have any children, they can be dismissed to Sabbath school. It's always fun and great snacks and all kinds of things. Oh, she decided if she was going to Sabbath school. It's fun. You're going to have fun. You should go. Okay. So, thank you guys very much. It's awesome. So, like I said, I haven't been up here in a while. Thank God that I'm up here to do what God want me to do tonight. So, I'm not going to be before you long, but like I always like to do, we have to make sure the temperature, atmosphere is right so that we can be able to receive from the Lord. Amen. So before we move forward, without the music, although they are awesome and great, we just want to give God glory and praise. So God, you're awesome. And you're mighty. And you're faithful. And there's nobody else like you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. We honor you, Lord. We come before you tonight with all that we have. We give it to you, Lord. We honor you. We bless you, Lord. It's not just me, it's you guys, people of God that love them. So tell them how much you love them. We just want to focus on you, Lord. We want to focus on you, Lord. You're wonderful. You're mighty, God. You're faithful. You're great, Lord. There's no one else like you in all the earth, Lord. You are good. Hallelujah. We bless you, Lord. We bless you. We bless you. Come on, 30 more seconds. We bless you. We bless you. We bless you. We honor you, Jesus. We honor you, Jesus. You are worthy. You are worthy. Nobody else like you, Lord. Hallelujah. We're going to go before the Lord in prayer and get in the word and get out of here. Amen. So God, we come before you tonight just saying thank you, Lord. We thank you for another day that you have granted us with, Lord. We know, Lord God, that if we're still alive, then we still have purpose, Lord God. So we thank you, Lord God, that you've given us another day to walk out your purpose in the name of Jesus. We pray, Lord God, that you would come and meet us, Lord God. There's a lot of people in here, different people. So I pray, Lord, in the name of Jesus, that you would make this word, that you would just make it for everyone to be able to understand it, Lord God, from their perspective in the name of Jesus. I pray, Lord God, that I'm completely invisible and that you are the only one sitting in the name of Jesus. I thank you, Lord God, that this is never about me, but this is all about you. We thank you, Lord God, for all that we've done up until this point, God. But we pray, Lord God, that in this moment that we're able to focus, Lord God, focus on your word and focus on what you have to say to us, Lord God. We come before you, Lord God, with open hearts in the name of Jesus. We come before you, Lord God, asking that you remove, Lord God, the veil from our eyes, Lord God, and that you would unclog our ears so that we can hear from you. God, we want more. We don't want anything else but you. For this is all about you. It remains about you. It's all about you. We want to make sure, Lord God, that you are our number one, Lord God, tonight as we focus on you being our number one, as we focus on making sure that you're our number one. Allow us, Lord God, to be in connection with you so that we can be convicted and compelled, Lord God, to do what it is that you call us to do. So, Lord God, that we can come back to our first love, Lord God, so we can remember and reflect, Lord God, and repent if necessary, Lord, to rekindle the fire that we once had for you. Because that is what it's all about. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. So you can be seated. You might have to stand up again, but you can be seated. It's good to be back up here. I haven't been up here for a minute. I looked at my last sermon notes, and I looked at something from like January 2016. I said, oh my goodness, I've had a little bit of a break. But it's always good to be able to bring the word. And so this fan, I got to put all the stuff down so the notes won't go away. So we're going to be coming from Philippians chapter 3, verses 7 through 11. And I have a couple of translations here that I want to read from because they just read so well. So the first translation is going to be the New Living Translation. We are all familiar with that here at 4M. So I'm going to go ahead and read that, and you can turn there with me. And it says, I once thought these things were valuable, but now I consider them worthless because of what Christ has done. Yes, everything else is worthless when compared with the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I have discarded everything else, counted it all as garbage, so that I can gain Christ and become one with him. I no longer count on my own righteousness through obeying the law. Rather, I become righteous through faith in Christ. For God's way of making us right with himself depends on faith. I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised him from the dead. I want to suffer with him, sharing in his death, so that one way or another, I will experience the resurrection from the dead. Amen? So that has a lot. It's real deep. And then something else that I want to read for your hearing is Philippians 3:10 from the Amplified. Absolutely was like, oh, this is amazing. I'm going to read Philippians 3:10a. I'm not going to read all the other parts. Because you know, if you read the Amplified, it gives you everything. And I don't read all that. So it says, Philippians 3:10. This is so good to me. For my determined purpose is that I may know him, that I may progressively become more deeply and intimately acquainted with him. It says, for my determined purpose is that I may know him, that I may progressively become more deeply and intimately acquainted with him. We're talking about being acquainted with Jesus. Amen? Amen. So tonight, I promise you I'm not going to be up here long because the Lord even told me that. So I got the Lord telling me, Pastor Kiva, we're going to be good. We're going to get it right and it's going to be good. So every time I'm given the opportunity to preach, I ask the Lord, what is it you want me to say? Because I never want to just come and talk about a whole bunch of things because that's easy to do, right? But I don't want to, say what Patrice wants to say because that could be a lot of other stuff that you all want to hear. And so I asked the Lord, I said, okay, what do you want to communicate to the people? Like, what is it that you want them to know? What's on your heart? What do you want them to know? So me and God went back and forth for about 3 days to make sure that I was hearing him clearly. You ever had those moments where you're like, you sure you're talking to me? You sure you want to say that? So I checked in with him. And he kept speaking the same thing. And I said, okay, Lord, we're going down this path. This is all good. It's going to be good with the people. Good with me. So I asked him, I said, again, Lord, please reveal to me what it is that you want your people to know. What do you want the people of Fort Hill to know? What do you want the people, the guests, the people that may be coming on that Saturday night to know about? And he said, I need and want my people to truly know me. I want them to know that in a lot of things that they are doing, they are missing me. I need them to know that I am not present, nor am I being invited, and I want to be. Wow. So when he said that to me, I'm like, like, that's pretty heavy. Like, what you're saying? Like, what are you communicating to me? And immediately, before he gave me the word to develop for our preach on Saturday, he began to deal with Patrice. And that's always good when the Lord begins to deal with you when you're bringing the word and when you're communicating God's word. So he began to talk to me about how in a lot of the things that we do, or in a lot of the things that I do, but I'm saying we because we're together, a lot of the things that we do, God is not present. I know that's hard to swallow. He began to show me very vividly, actually, like people, in churches and in worship, and he's not there. He began to show me people, at their workplace and having conversations. He ain't nowhere in the conversation. See, people in there, they don't come out. He began to show me people in their decision-making. Jesus, nowhere to be found. So this thing began to get real deep, because I'm like, all right, Lord, you're going to have me communicate this. You know the people going to be angry. He was like, no. It's going to be all good. And what he showed me was that don't just communicate to the people that I'm not present or, the things that they're searching after don't have me in them. Communicate to them how they can get back to making me their first love. Yeah. That's what the communication will be about tonight. Amen? So, like I said, he started to show me just little flashes of different scenarios and different things where we may have this concept that we think God is a part of it, and we're working hard and doing the work and, you know, running all around and doing all this stuff. And he was like, simply, I'm not there. Like, I'm not involved in those things. And he communicated to me that he so desperately wants to be involved with us. He so desperately wants to be in us and be with us. And we need to be focused and paying attention to all of his cues to make sure that he's a part of every aspect of our life. Amen? So this scripture is a passage of scripture that you guys have heard before. And the part that he lifted out of this for me this particular time was in the in verse 8, when it talks about, yes, everything else is worthless, right? When compared with the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. Everything else is worthless, right? It has no value. Nothing is in it. In New King James, it says everything, you know, is dumb, right? So that means it's boo-boo. So everything else is worthless when compared with the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. Right? So everything that we feel like has value, or we feel like is oh so important, God is communicating to us that it's not even that important. And it's not even that deep when you look at it being compared to your right relationship with God. Right? So the sermon title is My Number One, or Making Him Number One. Because that's what this is all about. So when he showed me this scripture, he had me focus on the special part about infinite value of knowing him. And he started to remind me of how having him in our lives is far greater than anything else. And I'll park right there, because a lot of times when we live our lives, we kind of, you know, when we first get saved and, you know, you got Jesus and you tell 50 million people and you're so excited, he changed my life. I used to do this, now I'll do this. You know how that works, right? You're so excited, you're so zealous, you're so on fire. And then for some people, it might be a week or a month later. I don't know, you can figure out your own time. But, you know, you get to this point where you don't have that same fire. You don't have that same connection that you had when you first met the Lord. Like, you lose some of that over time, right? And what God was communicating is that it's very important that throughout our walk with God, that we consistently pursue him so that we can stay connected. You know what I mean? Yeah, you'll have those seasons, you'll have those ebbs and flows, but it's very important for us to stay consistently connected with God. Amen?
Amen.
So he also said that sometimes we become deceived and begin to think that other things have more value than Christ, which that is like the ultimate deception, because we truly do know that there is true value in knowing Christ. So it's like, if when we're in our relationship with Christ, when we're with him, and say, for instance, we get disappointment, or there's some area of discontentment or something in our lives, we may put, you know, him to the back burner because we weren't happy with something that happened, or we didn't like the way he did something. So we'll begin to place all these other things and give all these other things value versus him having value in that number one place and status in our life. Amen? Yeah. So when this message came really interesting, because normally, you know, I'm like spending a lot of time like, okay, Lord, what do you want me to say? I'm writing it out in the manuscript. I have all the post-it notes, all this stuff, right? And this didn't come like that. It came very interesting in a time of prayer. And literally every time I went to prayer, because I thought that I was going to go to my laptop and get it all together and be able to present it to you guys in a nice package. Every time I went to prayer, the Lord was like, it's just that simple. Like, I want you to communicate to the people that they need to make me number one. And because there is And because I'm not number one in their life, like a lot of craziness and chaos and different things are happening because I'm not the first priority, right? So I said, okay, the Lord said, tell them I want to be their number one. Tell them that I want to be their number one. I want to be the one and only thing that matters. And I want to be the first love of their hearts. Not the second or the third, but the first love. I want them to get rid of the things that keep them away from me. So as I began to pray, it was like, you know, God was really communicating his heart. Like, I really, really, really want to make sure that my people understand that connection with me is important. This is not a joke. Like, this is not a thing that we play with. Like, it is a continual thing that we should be walking with. So I said, okay, what is number one mean? I'm sure, number one, right? number one, in terms of definition, it says one that is first in rank, importance, or influence, above everything else, establishing the order for everything else. So, you know, like in the number line, the number one establishes the order for everything else. You know, you got to have a number one before you have a number five or a number 10, right? I don't know that. Okay. And then also number one means the start. So I said, okay, Lord, this is okay. And he was saying to me that, Patrice, even in you praying and even in you, you know, putting this together, you are personally having difficulty because there's some areas in your life that you have to check to make sure I'm number one. I said, okay, cool, personal conviction, I'll do my stuff, right? And it was so crazy because the best part about really developing this sermon was hearing God communicate that, listen, I desire above everything else to be with you. I desire above all the other things that you put in my place. I'm still reminding you about removing those things from my place because I want to be connected. I'm constantly drawing you and drawing you and drawing you all the time. And the Lord is saying that he's constantly in a pursuit for us. He never stops pursuing us. We may stop pursuing him, but he never stops pursuing us. And he never stops pursuing us because of his love for us. He loves us so much that he, just think about it, you individually, he's on a pursuit, he's on a quest for the healing. So he's figuring out and working it out, like, how can I get her to focus? How can I get him to focus? What is it that I need to do? What problem, what thing am I going to allow to hit their life so they can wake up, pay attention, and realize that it's all about me?
That's right.
That's what he's talking about tonight. So, again, I said I told him I'll be before long. I have just three simple points. And when God gave this to me, I was like, this is like the easiest sermon I ever preached. And he was showing that, he was telling me that, because Patrice, he was saying that, you know, Patrice, it's not going to be so much about what you communicate and how long you communicate. It's going to be about the impact that you make when you're communicating. And I spent a lot of time praying that the hearts would be open to be able to receive this so that we can, by the end of this, we can focus and really rekindle our relationship with God. With Jesus. So three points. The first point is, which I've already reiterated, I'll do it again. Jesus is not our number one. He may be somewhere on the number line of our life, but not number one. He desires to be number one and the first of everything in your life. So you may be like, why is she keep repeating that? She said that once, we got it, we're gonna write it down. And some of the facial expressions that you have, or some of the facial expressions that I had, because I was like, all right, well, you drew this, I got it, number one, me, you, okay. And he kept communicating over and over and over to the point where it was uncomfortable. And it was so uncomfortable that it caused me in my little prayer closet in my apartment to cry out to God over and over and over again to make sure that I wasn't doing something or being a part of the emotions of a thing and not really having God. Do you know that we can participate in a lot of stuff that's godly? We can be in ministry. We can be also connected or look the part and don't have a relationship. I'm not talking about the stuff that you do. I'm not talking about the stuff that you do. I'm not talking about the fact that you come to church. I'm not talking about the fact that you have the YouVersion app and you read a couple of scriptures. I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about the gospel songs that you listen to. I'm not talking about the liqueur you might know. I'm not talking about that. What I'm talking about is real relationship with Jesus Christ. Because if we have real relationship with God, there will be fruit that manifests from our life. Right? If we have real relationship with Christ, there will be outcomes. There will be outcomes. There will be outcomes personally, and there will be outcomes for other people. And if this relationship was so tight, right, and if he was our first love so much, we would be wanting to tell people about, man, my relationship with Jesus is the best. The way he loves me is great. You know how it is when you have a first love and you get a first peace. Hello, please don't play, y'all. Seriously. Because it's easy for us to give these great accolades and adjectives and things to people, places, and things in our lives. When it comes to Christ and our relationship, we get spiritual amnesia. We forget about what he's done, how he's done it, how he's moved. First of all, we forget the fact that he died on a cross for us. Is that not enough for us to be in a position to seek after his face? This is not about what you do. Because the scariest thing is, we can be doing all this stuff. You know what I mean, Daddy? Doing all this stuff. Getting dressed up, putting on the clothes, texting the scriptures, praying to be put in the face, and God not be nowhere involved in it. He clearly communicated. He said, I'm the missing link. I'm the missing link. People got problems, they got stuff they go going through, their finances all crazy, whatever else we complain about, because we forget that he's Jehovah God and all those other things that we sing about all the time, right? We forget that most often. And I know this is a little harsh, but we're going to get to the good part because we're going to repent and really seek the Lord and be serious. I want to be serious. This is a message for serious people who are serious about their pursuit of actually going to heaven and not just talking about it. You know? So, he talked to me about scripture that you all know, Revelation 3:20. Look, I stand at the door and knock. Right? If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and I will share a meal together with you as friends. Simple. Listen, it says, look, I stand at the door and knock. The door of your heart. I'm constantly, Jesus, standing at the door knocking, waiting for you to open it. And the thing is, the Lord was talking to me about, yeah, so make sure that you communicate this, so if there's anybody in the house that doesn't have a relationship with God, it'll be clear that by the end of the sermon, if they don't have a relationship with God, we will open up the altar for salvation. Check, got that. Because I like to see souls saved. But the other piece is, the part B is, Patrice, most of the people that's going to be looking back at you, they have a relationship with me. Those are the people that say they have a relationship with me, that we tight. We connected. They tweet that. That's on the desk next to the kids and the husband. They got all the scriptures and all of that. And it's not that, hear me, it's not that those things are not true and that you don't love God. I'm not communicating that. What I am communicating is that it's important for you to make sure that in your everyday life and in your endeavors that he's a part of it. Because he wants to be a part of it. He wants to be a part of that. Okay? So, number two. First point was, Jesus is not our number one. We laid that foundation. We realized that there's some stuff that we got to shift around so he can have his, you know, proper alignment and that we can live an abundant life. How many people want to actually live an abundant life? There's a lot of stuff I read in the Bible. I'm like, hey, I want to experience that stuff. But I gotta do something, I gotta work at it, I gotta put something in so I can get something out of me, right? Number two, what has taken his place as number one in our lives? Well, this is like a focus moment. You gotta think about your own life. I can't tell you. He can tell me nothing about you, so I can't tell you. What has taken his place? What is the thing or the person? Because for some people, it's people. That has taken the place of Jesus Christ. Okay? The answer for this can be different for every person in this room. The point is, if we're really honest with ourselves, there is something that has taken its place. And we can think about that, and we know what that thing might be. So sometimes, the things that take up this number one space in our life, in our heart, are things that we may not think could take that place. So God showed me that the place that we give our problems and our situations and the issues of life, sometimes those things get in the way. You're like, what you talking about? If you're always talking about what you don't have, how it's not going well, and you complaining, that's taking Jesus' place. Or if you're always on the grind, and you pursue it, I gotta make this money, I gotta do this, I gotta, seven ways to get it and all that. Legacy and entrepreneurship, all of a sudden, is great because our pastor's preaching about that. However, not in the place of Jesus Christ. Because the only way you're gonna be successful, the only way you're gonna really grow in whatever your endeavor is having Jesus anyway. Right? Because we know that apart from Him, we can do nothing. Do you know that nothing that you do apart from Him will truly succeed? Yeah. You will be deceived and think it will succeed for a season, and that thing will fall and crumble because Jesus is not a part of it. Why do we want to do that? Why do we want to do that to ourselves? That's crazy. I'm a social worker, so they say when you keep doing stuff over and over and over, that's insanity. So I'm like, oh, please don't let the people of God be insane. Right? I'm talking to people every day. They do the same stuff over and over, expecting a different result. Do the same stuff. They come to my office doing the same stuff. I said, didn't I just tell you last week that if you do that same thing, you're gonna have the same result? And they leave and they come back and they're like, I did the same thing and I'm back here. Right. The point is, eventually, some point, you have to get it in your head to say, there has to be some sort of change so I can experience something different. I want to experience the difference in my life. Amen? All right. So another part B under this second point. Like I said, those things become major in our lives, pushing Jesus further and further away. We just put things in His place, and we push Him further and further and further away. And I know this is hard, but it's good. Everything is not going to always be an easy clap your hands, sit down. Woo, we put on. Everything's not going to always be like that. Especially when we're talking about spiritual maturity and really wanting the things of God. And we want to really grow. But it's going to be good. It's a good part to this, I promise. So, praise the Lord. just for some scriptural application for this point, in Hebrews 12, it talks about, let us lay aside every weight, right? And every sin which so easily ensnares us. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. That's key for us. We want to keep moving and walking this thing out. We got to lay aside every single thing that gets in the way of us progressing and moving in God, right? All right, point number three. Told you, I promise. How do we make Him number one again? How do we make Him number one again? So for some of you, your question is, how do I make Him number one? You might not have. And that's great, because we're going to talk so much about Him that by the end of this, you're going to want to say, how can I meet Jesus? Because that's the prayer that I pray. But then two, for those of us that have Him, how do we make Him number one again?
Amen.
Because at one point, He was number one.
Amen.
Right? So the first thing you can do is remember. You can remember what He did and how it was for you. By remembering who Jesus is, your Savior, your God, your
with him. Because you'll remember what he did for you. Amen?
Amen.
Two, you can make a decision. You can make a decision that you will make him number one in your life. That you will make him a priority. And you desire for him to be a priority so that everything else can be aligned. Because it's all about him. It's all about him. This walk is all about growing in him. It's all about that. Three. Now we spend some time on this one. Repent. So we talked about remember, making a decision, and repenting. All the retreats. Woo, repentance. Not something that people like to talk about, but it is something that is necessary if you want to walk with the Lord. Repentance is a serious, true thing that can actually help you out in a lot of situations. You've got to turn back to the Lord and acknowledge that he's who he said he was. So repent. Return back to God and turn away from the things that keep you from him. Repentance requires true brokenness. Repentance is not asking the Lord for forgiveness with the intent to sin again. Repentance is honest acknowledgement of sin with a commitment, a desire to change. Repentance leads us to cultivate godliness while eradicating habits that lead to sin. Okay? So, you got to remember, if you want to make him number one, you got to remember, first of all, what he did for you, that he saved you, he's a sin substitute, is Jesus Christ. Two, you got to make a decision. You got to make a serious decision. You got to look at yourself in the mirror and say, self, I'm tired of doing the same thing over and over. This is draining, okay? I'm getting the same result. I got some people that agree on me, so praise the Lord, I can witness it. Right? I'm tired of this. Or make a decision that I'm moving all that stuff out of the way and whatever I gotta do. So that means I might have to leave some people, I might have to switch where I'm at. I don't know, I gotta eat different, but I don't know. Whatever it is I gotta do, I gotta do something. I gotta make a decision that I'm gonna do that. Because this is just that serious, right? So I'm gonna remember, make a decision, repent, which is returning back to God. That's what this is all about. Returning back to him. The fourth thing we're going to do is rekindle. Rekindle our relationship with him. Rekindle means to relight, to excite, to stir up, to arouse anew, to cause to burn again. We want to rekindle our relationship with him because it's so important that we have a relationship with him. Jeremiah 29:13-14 in the Message Bible says, when you come looking for me, you will find me. Yes, when you get serious about finding me and want it more than anything else, I'll make sure you won't be disappointed. That's the Bible. Jeremiah 29:13-14, I'm reading it in the Message, but you can look it up and all I'm saying to me is say, when you come looking for me, when you out there, come looking for Jesus. For real. No games, no gimmicks, like we like to say. You really come looking for him, your desperation, you serious, you're not playing. When you come looking for him, he says, yes, you will find me. Yes, when you get serious about finding me, and want it more than anything else, I'll make sure you won't be disappointed. That's God talking. When you get serious about your relationship with me, when you see that above everything else, that you are the most important one, that you have to be number one in my life. When you make that acknowledgement, when you get serious about it, he's saying, hey, you're going to be disappointed. You're going to find me. And not only are you going to find me, you're going to find purpose. You're going to stop running around trying to figure out what you're supposed to do, how you're supposed to do it, all that running. Don't y'all get tired, honey? in?
Yes.
Okay, yes, okay. Okay, my brother says yes. He's top one. His feet hurt.